and that nobody had seen it. Lashbrook said he was asleep and was awakened by the sound of crashing glass. And we were simply told that there had been an accident and that my father had died. What was immediately suspicious, of course, was that he didn't open the window. He went through a closed window in the dark. The shade was drawn, and Lashbrook allegedly was asleep during the whole thing and didn't hear a thing until the crashing glass.
And your belief is?
Well, my belief is that story makes no sense whatsoever, and that, his death was extremely convenient for them. I mean, one of the things you have to realize is that his death was not a tragedy for them. It actually solved the problem. Because my father if what they say is true, my father was suffering symptoms inflicted by a weapon which was not acknowledged to exist, namely LSD as a tool for mind control. So they were in a horrendous corner. Once they had drugged him and he was A, disturbed, B, angry, C, disoriented, they had a real problem. Because had they put him in a mental hospital, as they said they were going to do, there was no way they could control the damage. He was, according to them, saying that he had been drugged, and that he was upset by that, and that he was suspicious that drugs were continually being placed in his beverages. Well, that's sort of like the Emperor's New Clothes story. He had been drugged by a drug placed in a drink. And I think they had to control this damage in some way.
Dr. Eric Olson, we're also joined by Martin Lee, co-author of Acid Dreams, the CIA, LSD, and the 60s Rebellion. We only have a few minutes, Martin Lee, but the stories you're hearing about Paul Robeson and also Frank Olson, I don't know that we can lump them together. How does this fit into your investigation of the MKULTRA project?
The Frank Olson tragedy certainly was a direct result of the MKULTRA program, but that was part of the experimental phase of what CIA was doing with LSD in particular and drugs in general. The situation with Paul Robeson, assuming that indeed it was a drugging, as it appears it may well have been, would have been an operational use of a drug. The drug BZ that Paul Robeson Jr. suspects is a different chemical category from LSD. It's in some ways a more potent drug in terms of its effects, although not in terms of the amount one would need to ingest to have those effects. BZ lasts anywhere from 3 days to 6 weeks, very, very bizarre experiences one would have that's somewhat different from LSD, which tends to last about half a day or so, the actual immediate effects. But the after effects can be very profound and very unsettling, particularly if one is given it surreptitiously. And ultimately what the CIA was trying to do when it dosed Frank Olson, leading to his death, whether it was by suicide or murder, was to figure out how to use LSD in an operational context. And eventually the CIA employed LSD in a number of different ways. One was as a discrediting agent. The idea is to slip it to a person surreptitiously without them knowing, and then that person would end up acting foolishly in public, let's say, before they're about to give a speech. They would target enemy politicians this way. And it's clearly documented that LSD was used by the CIA operationally in this way. Among the targets they wanted to use LSD was against Fidel Castro, against Gamal Abdel Nasser in Egypt. Those politicians did not get hit with LSD, but others did. Their names are deleted from the CIA documents. There are other ways that LSD was used operationally, also as an interrogation weapon. The idea here was give a person LSD without them knowing. Within an hour or so, once the effects of the drug start to come on, oftentimes the person would be very confused and disoriented, a great deal of anxiety. They wouldn't know necessarily they'd even been drugged. And they'd start to hallucinate, literally go crazy. And the CIA interrogator would say at that point, well, we're going to keep you in this condition forever, this crazed, anxiety-ridden mental condition, unless you tell us what we want to know. So
Martin,
it's like a third-degree tactic.
I'm going to cut you off there because the show is ending, co-author of Acid Dreams, and wrap up with Paul Robeson Jr. So where do you go from here? How do you prove this? How do you find out more information?
Could well have been LSD or BZ. I can't you know, for sure make that distinction, but I have enough evidence now and enough recollections of my own experience, enough data from the hospital records to make a case, public case,
and we're
retrieving documents and to challenge the CIA to come up with an explanation.
We will certainly follow this case, Paul Robeson Jr., Dr. Eric Olson, and Martin Lee. 1-800-735-0230 is the number to call to order a cassette of today's show. 1-800-735-0230. Thanks to Errol Maitland, David Love, and Maria Carrion. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks for listening.